In the last couple of videos, I've been looking at two alternative ways of configuring the exact mappings in Entity Framework Core between your entities in C# code and your tables and columns in the database. And those two approaches were to use attributes and to use the Fluent API. And one thing I mentioned was that one of the things we can do with Fluent API is we can actually make decisions, have conditionals or whatever, to exactly how the mapping's going to work. And so this week I'm going to show an example of that, work it through to show you how it can be beneficial and how we actually make it work. And what I'm going to do is show you something I do quite often, which is on a website where you need to be multilingual. So where the text needs to vary depending on the user's choice of what language they want to go with. And the way I do this is very often like this. What we've got here is that website. And I'll just run it up so we can see how it looks to start with. And you can see what we've got is just a simple website with this message, hello, welcome to my website. It changes language dynamically. And then we've got here three language buttons on the top left. And if I click them, we can see it's changing the flag that's highlighted, but it doesn't as yet actually change from English to French to Turkish or whatever we may want. So we've got to implement that to make that work. Now, if we look at the code, we can see that in actual database terms, I have got this language library.db, and if we take a look in there, we can see that contains actually three tables, one for each of the languages I'm dealing with. And the important thing about this is that each of those tables has exactly the same structure. So if we look at English fragments to start with, then we can see it's got an ID, which is a string column, and we've got text. And so the ID is just a simple universal identifier for the message I want. So I just call them hello, welcome, and changes. And then because this is English fragments, we've got the English equivalent of that. I've then got my French fragments, exactly the same IDs, but French messages, and exactly the same in Turkish as well. So as a programmer, as a designer of this website, I'm just simply going to say, put in the welcome message, put in the changes message, and we want to pick out the appropriate one there. And it's quite nice to do it like this because it means you can then take a table like this, leave the IDs in there, hand it over to your translator, and they just have to fill in the text. But if we look at the code, unlike anything we've seen before, we don't have just the one-to-one mapping between tables and entities. We're in fact managing this entirely through a single entity called text fragment. So the tables have got English fragments, French fragments, Turkish fragments, but they're all going to map on to this one entity depending on circumstances. And to do that dynamic mapping, we need to do that using the Fluent API. So if we look in our language context, you can see that I've done here my on model creating, and I've done the model builder entity to table. So you remember from the last video, this is the way that we can change the name of the table compared with the name of the entity class. But then I've got this string that is actually going to be formed dynamically because it's going to end in fragments. Because remember, each one of our tables we've just followed a convention said ends in fragments, but it begins with language, and language is a property, and it's actually being read based on the cookies that have been sent in with the request. So we've got this thing called HTTP Context Accessor that allows us to look through at the cookies. And so I'm hoping there is going to be a cookie called language, which is either going to say English or French or Turkish or extend that to whatever we want. If it's blank, I'm just defaulting to English. I get hold of this by injection, in fact. So our DB context, the constructor, is injectable, and there we're injecting this interface for the context accessor. And the only other thing I've had to do is in the startup, which we've got down here, I've configured that for injection. So by putting that in there, anything that's injectable will receive this thing. Now, actually, this isn't a particularly common thing to need to do. The reason being that the most common thing we inject into is a controller, and controllers have access to the HTTP context anyway. But in this case, we're trying to inject the HTTP context into the DB context, and that doesn't happen automatically, so that's why we've got to put that in there. So that's what we've got there, and then our language context just picks that up, and that's where we get the cookie from. So here we're going to have the appropriate table, English or French or Turkish fragments, mapped onto just our single text fragment entity class. The way we then get that into the view itself is to use a tag helper. Now, we're covering a lot of different technologies here, and I want to focus on the entity framework. So I'm not going to talk too much about tag helpers, but I will be doing a video later on them. But basically, the tag helper gets injected with the DB context, and then based on the ID, so remember we had, say there, the ID of changes or hello or welcome, it simply looks up the appropriate text fragment whose ID matches this ident property and then generates a span containing the content. So if we look at the view itself, so if we go to our index view, then you can see here, this is where we actually use our tag helper. So there we've got the first fragment in an H1 with an ident of hello. Then we've got the ident of welcome. Then we've got the ident of changes. So that is going to call the tag helper here, which is going to pull the data out of the DB context, put it into a span. But then, of course, the DB context is going to be configured depending on what came in through the cookies. And so that's what we end up with, all of that there. So if we run that up, actually, and we just take a look at the generated source, then we can see that what it's done here is there we've got the spans, just in this case with the English context that was fetched out. Now, the other thing we've therefore got to do is we've got to make something happen when these buttons are pressed. And that has to be done in JavaScript. So if we go back in here and take a look at our JavaScript, we can see that what I've got here is a couple of helper functions. Actually, I'd normally put these in a library just to make the cookie manipulation a little bit easier because they're a bit fiddly in JavaScript. So I've essentially got a set cookie and a get cookie. And the first thing I do is I get this language cookie and again default it to English, but I use that to determine the current language. And so with that, I'm then applying a selected language class to the button. And that's what means when we run this up, that the English one is the highlighted one. If I went for French, now that's highlighted, or back to English we have there. So that's just highlighting it based on the current cookie. But then the other thing I do is, if one of those language buttons is clicked, then I set the cookie to be whatever's in the title there. So if again we look at, in this case, the layout, we can see here, each of those buttons, I've got my English and my French and my Turkish, and so whichever one's clicked, that is going to be used as the value that we're setting in the cookie. Now, having done that, of course, then to actually get the new language, I need to refresh the page. So I just do a reload then, and that re-requests the page. But of course, in that request, it sends the cookie to the server. And then on the server, we can see that the DB context will look at that cookie, choose the language and send things back. Or at least you'd hope it would. We should have everything working there for now, but it's not actually quite working right. Because if I do that, then when we change language, it is refreshing. You can just see the icon flashing, but it's not changing language. Well, actually, it almost is. If I were to leave that on Turkish and then shut this down and then restart it, the cookie, remember, will be preserved in the browser because they persist. And now we can see we've got the Turkish greeting. So it's almost worked. The problem is that in Entity Framework Core, we have actually what is a very nice feature in that when we look at our DB context, the model builder details are actually cached as part of the dependency injection mechanism. So if I put a couple of breaks in here, if I put a break on the constructor and also put a break on the on model creating, and then go back to here, if I click on English, we can see it does break on the constructor, so it does create a new DB context, but it doesn't break on the on model creating. It's cached that information, and therefore it doesn't have to call it again and again and again. If I run it up, then obviously, because we've started again, it can't be cached, and so it will call it the once there, but that means it only ever calls it for whatever language, in this case English, it happens to have been configured to. It won't do it again, and so that's why we don't see the change. And that's very important in terms of performance, because you wouldn't want to waste time unnecessarily reconfiguring your entity mapping every time you accessed it. But here we do want to do that. Now you might think, well, let's just turn off that caching, but that would be really horrible because then it would be doing it every time. It would be very inefficient. So what we really want to do is not have one cache, but we want to have three. We simply want to cache it three separate times, once for each of our languages, or again, however many languages we have. And that's something we can do. And that's really the new bit that we've got to put in here to make this work with Entity Framework. So what we have to do is this. We need to, in the same folder, I'm going to add a new class. And I'm going to call this class my language cache key factory. Because what we're trying to do here is, as I say, create three caches. One for French, one for English, one for Turkish. And so this is going to create the cache key, the keys being those three different languages. We have to implement an interface here, which is iModelCacheKeyFactory. So that's what we need to put in there. And then if we just implement that interface, we have this create that takes in a DB context, and then, not helpful at all, just returns an object. And this object can actually contain the information we want in a number of different ways. So you will see other examples, but this is the way I'm going to do it. What we're going to return as this object is simply an anonymous type. So I'm going to say return new, and then just curly braces for the anonymous type. And then what we put in here is the type of the DB context that this should apply to. So that's going to be context.getType. Now, because this is a simple application with only the one DB context, we can be pretty much sure that that is actually our language context. But for safety, we really need to just cater for the possibility that other contexts could come through here as well. So we say type equals getType, and then we call this language, because that's the thing we want to switch on. And then basically this is where we put a safety check in. So we say context is language context. So we check it's the right type of language context. And if it is, we then can assign that into a variable that we're just going to call language context. So what we're doing there is we're checking it's a language context. And if it is, we put it into the variable. And if it is, we are going to return language context dot language. So that is the property we had here that was based on the cookie. So it's going to look in there to see if it's already cached it. So if it had already run for English and the cookie returns English, then it knows it's cached it and it won't have to run on model creating again. But if it's cached English and we ask for Turkish, then it will have to run on model creating just once for Turkey. So that's what we're specifying there. And then just for safety, because we've got these other contexts as well, we just return null for any other context, saying they can just be cached following the normal rules. So it's a little bit odd, but it's fairly simple once you understand the concept. And once you've done this once, you typically just copy and modify the code for all the different circumstances. So that's done what we have there. And then lastly, we've obviously got to register this. So let's go into startup. And in startup, here we've got our basic registration of the SQLite database. And then the other thing we have to do, so on the end of that use SQLite, so in there, we're going to say dot, and then replace service. So this is taking out the standard implementation of iModelCacheKeyFactory. That was the interface we based it on, and replacing it with our own, this language cache key factory. Okay, so that is saying this is the factory you should use for the cache keys. The default one simply caches it once, as we saw. So having done that, if we now run this up, that should get everything working. So it's gone in as English as a default, but if we click on French, we can now see it does now work successfully. It immediately changes. We've got French there, and then we've got Turkish or French or English, and we can switch around like that. Let's just look at what's happening in the debugger. So I'll close that down so that we clear out the cache, put a break on that on model creating, and then run that. And so now we see the first time it comes in, the language in this case is English. So that's going to create the appropriate mapping for English, and we see the English displayed. If I then click French, it's a different language, so it's a different key for the cache, so it's going to do it for French. Whereas now if I go back to English, it doesn't break there because it's cached the English, cached the French. Turkish, first time we go in there, it's got to do that. But now all three of them have been cached, and so we'll do no further mapping for the entire lifetime of the site until it's restarted or whatever. So it's not just on a per browser basis, that's going to be for everybody. And you can see it's pretty quick, and it's a really nice way of doing multilingual sites. Quite a number of different aspects of that, and I wanted to focus on the empty framework part of it, but we also saw the use of cookies. We saw cookies in JavaScript on the client side, and then also how we can use the injection of the HTTP context to read cookies anywhere on the server side. We also saw tag helpers, which I'll be talking more about in a later video, that made it quite easy to put this code in there. And then the main thing, as I say, was entity framework, where we looked at this cache key factory to specify multiple different configurations of the database based on some kind of key. So I hope you enjoyed that. Do like it if you did, and do subscribe. Next time, we're going to be looking at many-to-many relationships and things like that in entity framework.